Take a couple seconds to just explain kind of the creation of this chapter and where this all started. You also see the Women Empowerment one pager on your chair. This is from our OWS event in San Antonio. We launched our first panel there, and we launched some of the findings of the survey we did. So if you're interested in the full report, it's on there. Just go to the link, you know, put it in your browser, and it'll take you. This all started because we did a survey with in collaboration with the Avasant Foundation on women empowerment and opportunity in outsourcing. And from then, it just kind of built a lot of traction. We had a lot of following and a lot of interest. So we've been working to create a chapter around this. Now, this is the first launch of that. It will be a topical chapter. So if you're interested in future meetings, they'll always be virtual for the most part. But Michael was kind enough to invite us to collaborate with Dallas here. So we're really, really excited. So this is our kickoff. So thank you for being here. Thank you. If you have any input, obviously, we'd love this to be a super interactive panel. So get involved. If you have any input on some of the topics, it's a really broad topic. So, you know, if you have some insight, and I'm sure some of you have dealt with initiatives around this in your company, and what we'd like to see with this chapter is not just educational and informative, but also trying to implement some of the things we learned. So finding case studies, what companies are really implementing incredible initiatives and finding, you know, good outcomes, and how can we transfer that to other companies. So we'd like it to be really interactive as the chapter grows. So, you know, feel free to reach out with any interest. If you disagree, get involved. If you agree, get involved. I don't want to take any more time, so feel free to catch me after if you have any questions or want to discuss anything further. Thank you so much to our panelists for being here. I'll hand it over to Debbie, and we'll get started.
Thank you. Thank you, Dana. As Dana said, we want it to be interactive, so we do have some prepared questions. I hope we don't get through more than two, because what I think is really important is to hear what everybody else has to say. So what I'd like to do first is have each of the panelists introduce themselves and, you know, maybe say what brings you to the topic, what brings you here today, what your passion is around it. So can we start with you, Sarah?
Sure. Hi, I'm Sarah Wiseman. I work for JLL, or Jones Lang LaSalle, as we're also known in the marketplace. I have worked in outsourcing probably one way or another through my entire career. I work in real estate services, outsourcing. When I started in the workforce in the mid-90s, I worked in technology. So I've been around it. My passion around the women's empowerment thing comes, I mean, obviously it's personal. I'm a female, I work. But I lead teams, I lead high-performing teams. And I think that as someone who manages people, half those people tend to be women. And it's really important as a leader that you are close to the issue, what's going on, and how to help other people advance. So, I mean, it's obviously, I'm involved in a lot of things within JLL, including our Women's Business Network, but even if I weren't, I have an obligation to the people who work for me, male and female, to make sure that they're getting what they need out of their work experience, and I'm pretty passionate about that.
Thank you. Anybody have a comment? Kate?
Perfect. So I introduced myself a little bit earlier. I'm a professor at the University of Tennessee. Before being a professor, though, I actually had real jobs. so I was on the buy side. I worked for Microsoft in the early 1990s. Remember Windows 95, right? Mm-hmm. In boxes of software behind you, 23 diskettes. and so led a lot of their early outsourcing initiatives. And then I worked for Microsoft's largest supplier at the time, who, by the way, most people would never know this, right? But at the time, early 90s, 23 diskettes, a pretty box, Windows DOS manual. It was actually R. Donnelly & Sons. It was a printer. So, yeah, so it was a printer. It was their largest supplier. So I worked from there. So I've been on the buy side, been on the sell side. And I came out graduated from the University of Tennessee with a degree in supply chain management. And my first job was actually Procter & Gamble. And I remember going to a Council of Supply Chain Management Professionals conference, and they had a women's group. And back then, like, only 3% of women were in supply chain, because what women goes into trucking and warehousing and stuff like that, right? And when we were talking, so it says, you know, you go and there's all these bitch sessions. And when you talk about women, oh, it's a glass ceiling. And and you know, me personally, coming out at that time, I've never been discriminated against, ever. You know, I and so you look at it, and you've all these mother that had pay salary, but the vast majority, the huge amount of statistics, it still looks pretty bad. But you look at the students who are coming out of the University of Tennessee in supply chain management, instead of 3%, it's 30-some-odd%. So it's huge strides, and I think there's just some professions that lended itself to men in the past that now, I mean, look at all the women here, outsourcing. And so I think that, you know, I get passionate when we actually don't look at the big picture and the statistics, because the statistics don't tell the truth about what's happening now.
Thanks, Kate. That's great. Michael.
Hi, I'm Michael Nacarado. Work for Freedom Mortgage Corp. I've been in outsourcing and offshoring, right? That shows how long I've been in, where people actually call it outsourcing or offshoring. It's all outsourcing. Been very passionate about this business. Before I learned about Vested, trying to change the culture internally from a male-predominant industry group, even within the organization, back 15 years ago, you didn't go to school. We talked about 10, 15 years ago, maybe five universities that were known for having a supply chain or any kind of outsourcing degree. And now it's changed. The numbers are increasing. And as I have a personal and a business perspective, right? From a business perspective, I have to run the business. We have entire companies to draw from and labor pools. And limiting yourself to just half or a quarter of a labor pool is not a good business practice. Now, on the personal side, my father was one of three boys, I was one of three boys, so I never actually cohabitated with a woman until I got married at 33, so that was like shocking to me, and now I have this beautiful 13 and a half year old daughter who's coming to me and saying, Dad, I love science, I love math, but none of my friends do, they think I'm weird. And I said, you know, it's almost like you talk about the SERPA. For my daughter, I need to be engaged in women's empowerment. I need to be one of those SERPAs. We have the older generation that have maybe, you know, carved a different path. So we've got to be part of, you know, engaging in women's empowerment issues. And I want to be able to say that I contributed to my daughter having an easier path. So it's something we're passionate about. When I heard at OWS that we were starting this chapter, I said, wow, this chapter is going to be the most popular chapter of all the 40 plus chapters we have. So it's exciting to see it come together from an idea at OWS and gaining traction.
Yeah, that's really great. We are seeing that. Dana's doing an amazing job along with the leadership team of the chapter to really do more and more for us to develop content around it, of course, and see where it goes. One of the things I would just like to note is that in the 25 years basically been doing this, and over the past 20 years of the Outsourcing World Summit, it was predominantly men on the program. Up until this year, it was predominantly men on the program. So we get a lot of answers to the call for presentation every year, and we look at them all carefully, and we place them in the checkerboard of where it fits in the summit. And this year, I am thrilled to say, half of the presentations we've received so far are from women executives who want to be part of the program. And that is a big change.
Thank you very much.
I think we've been criticized. And I remember one time sitting with someone who said, I can't believe you don't have enough women. I said, would you like to speak one? I'm not sure. I said, well, there you go. Here's the problem. So that's very gratifying. So I just wanted to share that. So make sure you get to the summit and get involved in this chapter. I will do a couple of questions, okay? And then I think I want to open it up a little, and I want to hear a little bit more from you, Sarah, specific experiences, perhaps, if you could share that. So let me just start with the first question. These were prepared by the chapter leadership team. IAP and the Avasan Foundation survey launched in 2016 to assess women empowerment and opportunities in outsourcing, and results of the survey showed 84% of women felt a need to enhance opportunities for women in the outsourcing industry. What could be some of the ways to do this? Within your own organizations, have you seen any successful initiatives implemented? So that's for the panel, but please, it's open for everyone. So I guess we could start, Sarah?
Sure.
Can you address that?
Yeah, you know, and I thought about that question, and I thought about, could I come up with an initiative that I thought was particularly effective, or where did I think the gap was? particular pet peeve in my professional life, and it's about bad managers. My favorite bad manager story is I had to fire somebody for another manager because I thought we'd get in a lot of trouble if I let them do it. It's a pet peeve of mine. I mean, I manage teams. And when I thought about that question, I thought, you know, initiatives are great. They're wonderful. But maybe if we just trained our people managers how to be better people managers and to help their employees with the basics and to understand what some of this stuff was, we wouldn't need so many initiatives. I think what often happens in large organizations, certainly JLL is this highly matrixed organization, right? And we're like the opposite of Accenture in terms of having a career development plan. At Accenture, you come in, you're a consultant for 2 years, a lot of people leave, they go through the revolving door, the rest of them become senior consultants, more people leave, they become managers, you have this sort of very rote thing. JLL says, hi, here's your laptop. And it's a wonderful environment. You can do whatever you want. I worked in HR for 6 years. I work in the business now. Nobody ever did that before. I don't think anybody's ever done it since, but nobody told me I couldn't do it, so I went and did it. But no one tells you how to get anything done. And most people, and I think this is true in every organization I've worked in, it's not just a JLL thing, people become people managers because they have functional and technical skills. You're a good engineer. You become a chief engineer. We have the other engineers report to you. Being a good technical chief engineer doesn't mean you know how to manage people. It doesn't mean when that junior person comes to you and says, this is my career aspiration. I really want to understand energy and sustainability. I want to go and do this. That manager has the tools to help you do that. And when bias never even enters in, gender bias never even has to enter into it at that point. If your manager doesn't have the skills and the network to help you out, it doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman, you're automatically disadvantaged. It makes it that much harder. And so from my perspective, if you get the basics right a little more of the time in that regard, women would be much better off, because often that's one of the challenges that we have. We don't know who we go talk to. We don't know who we ask to be our mentor. You don't know who you want to be your advocate. You need someone to help you figure those things out. Who you go to? You go talk to your line manager. And if your line manager has no idea how to do those things, or how to counsel someone on how to do it, or how to share effectively how they've done it, you're really going to struggle, whether there's programs in place to identify high value talent women or anything else, especially in outsourcing, because you end up with something that I like to refer to as account isolation. If you're actually someone who's out on an account, I mean, I've often worked in infrastructure and at the platform level, but if you're servicing Capital One, and the only people you ever interact with are the people on the Capital One account, how do you know what's going on the P&G account, or the Bank of America account, or the HSBC account, or the other 238 accounts that you could go work on? You don't know. And if your manager's not able to help you, you're just incredibly disadvantaged, I think. So I honestly think some pulling back a little bit from the high thinking initiative a little bit and stepping back and thinking about how do we actually train our managers? How do they know it's a priority to help their employees, to develop their employees? People might be better off all the way around.
That's great.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, I like what you said there, because, you know, as a young person coming out of college with a supply chain management degree when there were very few women, you know, I went to work for Procter & Gamble, and I remember going to my first CSCMP conference and being full of women. You know, they had their first ever women, you know, equivalent to women empowerment. And you don't see that. And so I honestly, you know, I'm 48 years old. I have never, ever felt there was a glass ceiling. When I worked at Microsoft, I didn't feel there was a glass ceiling. When I worked at Darwin or Dahlia, I didn't feel there was a glass ceiling. When I worked at P&G, there wasn't a glass ceiling. And so I think it's kind of a company thing that you have to just, companies need to start with some of those basics. And then the best women don't work for them. P&G never had a diversity issue because they actually went out and people wanted to work at P&G. People want to work. You don't have trouble recruiting women. In real estate, I mean, come on, real estate used to be a good old boys, right? Why does JLL have so many women? Because you've done work on the basics. You know, and P&G has been very successful at diversity because they've worked the basics and the people know that that's a great company to work for because they're going to work for people that really understand how to manage people. I like that. I had never heard of that perspective before, but I think you're spot on.
I like to be a contrarian, okay?
So you're saying you don't see that across the board?
I don't, and I thought it was interesting when Kate said it because I'm a little ashamed sometimes telling that to people because I feel like people do really see it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I would never, you know, if a woman came to me and said, you know, I feel that I'm being negatively impacted in XYZ scenario because of my gender. I would never want to tell someone it doesn't happen. It has not happened to me. And I was pretty far along in my career before I even ever had somebody say something that even had a whiff of impropriety to it in that way. And when it happened, I was just, I almost missed it. Like it was so outlandish to me that it really didn't register with me. But I will say this, and I think some of that, and I'm gonna guess the same about you, is that I just kind of did what I wanted to do. It literally never occurred to me in my professional life that anybody would ever tell me I couldn't do something or shouldn't do something or wouldn't be good at something because I was a woman. The thought never entered my head. And so some of it may just be that I'm obstinate about it. So if somebody was thinking that, I may have just ignored it. Do you know what I mean? I think on the individual level, I mean, that's the advice I would give people. Like, don't have the self-fulfilling prophecy. Don't think that somebody's going to tell you you couldn't or you shouldn't. Because as soon as you, that's just like asking for trouble. As soon as you open that and put that out in the universe, somebody can do it to you. Mm-hmm. If you never think it's possible, then.
Sure. Something as simple as, do you think I can do it?
It's interesting that y'all, both of your comments, like, I personally have never experienced any kind of limitations in my career because I'm a woman, but I've seen colleagues of mine in the exact same company experience that, and it's interesting, the two companies that I worked at prior to this one, I could see it, and they didn't focus on the basics. They didn't educate their managers. They didn't, you know, allow them to manage people. They were managing processes.
Yeah.
And it's a complete culture shift, you know. And coming to the company I'm at now, it's amazing. They foster that kind of environment where they focus on people. They focus on building that relationship, and it makes a world of difference because I've never once felt anything like that at the company I'm at now. And I'm not saying that just because my voice is right.
So I don't know how you are. I'm
43. 43? Come on now.
36. But there's a lot of people in there that have been in those jobs, so the sheer vast number of statistics is going to say there's discrimination.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But our age isn't there. And so when I look at it as being a professor, now in academia, you know, how do we get more women in logistics and supply chain? It used to be 3%. Now we have over a third of our supply chain students are women. And it's because we go educate them. No, transportation, that's not the good old boy thing. Look, there's really good companies that do this. Look, you can have a supply chain degree at
really don't mean that there's no glass ceiling, that it happens, that it does happen. But there's a lot of sticky floor too, because, and I see this with women who work for me. I had a woman who used to work for me, and she called me. She didn't work for me anymore. She was being offered a role. She said, "Sarah, I don't know if I should do this." And I said, "Why? You've been telling me for like 2 years that you, this is what you want to do." She said, "I think I might get pregnant. I'm thinking about having a baby. Just do it anyway." And she, and her reaction was, "I don't want to let somebody down. I don't want to take it and then go out on leave. I don't want to do this, that, and the other." And I said, "Well, are you going to take the job and like beat the hell out of it the way you do with things?" And she said, "Well, yeah, sure." I said, "Do you know you're going to get pregnant? No. Do you know when you're going to get pregnant? No. Could you do this job for 2 years and be ready to go on to another job before you get pregnant? Well, yeah. Could you get pregnant tomorrow? So what?"
Yeah.
But I think there's sticky floor stuff like that that happens. And I do think women ask themselves questions that men wouldn't.
Right.
Like one of the guys who works for you, who would never say, "Well, my wife's going to have a baby. Maybe I should take that job. She's going to be home a little more." He'd say, "My wife's going to have a baby. That job's going to pay more.
Right.
I'm going to take it."
Okay. Yeah.
You know, and women, I think maybe we're not quite as self-serving, or not as comfortable being self-serving, or we worry too much about other people. And I think you get into sticky floor situations as much as you have like the bona fide person holding you down. Sometimes you're holding yourself back,
right.
Which is harder issue maybe to solve, actually.
Yeah.
But if you look at PepsiCo, today, the CEO of PepsiCo, Indra Nui, from my school, I am director, and you can see there's no glass ceiling, you know. She has really made it her way to the top, you know. Yeah.
I hate to be the one that, I do think there's a glass ceiling, and I think, and I'm 10 years on all of the ones everybody's talking more. I worked for a very toxic company, and I really think it comes down to the way they worked with people, the way they managed people. It was toxic.
Yeah.
Didn't really see it. Thank God I'm not there anymore. But I think it comes down to the culture of the company and the values. What are the core values of a company? What do they believe in? But I do think it's still there, and I think the statistics will say that women still make less than men.
So, yeah, and I think,
I think it's like 30%.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you might not have been discriminated, you might have been, you know, you might have been
new
at the
folks race. Coming out, though, is where I say it doesn't. So, we know, like, our top 10 graduates, you know, the majority are women,
mm-hmm.
and we see their salaries. There is no discrimination in the young kids these days. I will absolutely agree. The older and older older you get, it is absolutely there. So
right.
I 100% don't want to say it doesn't happen, but what I'm saying is you start to get to people about my age with progressive companies and to about your age, you know, give you another 10
mm-hmm.
years,
mm-hmm.
it's even less.
Mm-hmm.
And you get the kids that are coming out of school now, it's not there.
And it depends
but
on
the math is made up of all the whole thing.
So the statistics are skewed.
So if you looked at the last 5 years, you would see no salary differentials.
Mm-hmm.
If you looked at the whole, of course there's going to be massive salary differentials.
And each of the 10 years
difference, right? You look at somebody who's 10 years your senior, it absolutely, blatantly,
and also there's a big discrepancy, I think, in corporate America in general. I'm not trying to do a pitch session. In corporate America in general, the disparity of what, say, a vice president versus that C-suite is making. Why does it have to be so large?
I have a theory about that, about part of what contributes to that. I think there's two things that women do that impact it, outside of the general, because we do get paid worse, right?
Right.
Part of the reason we get paid worse is because they can do it to us. And they can do it for one very important reason. And they're
I'm glad I'm not in this room.
We don't negotiate on our behalf.
Yeah.
And when my niece is 23 years old, she graduated from college, she has a mechanical engineering job, and she got some very bad advice from her dad, and I had to hold myself back. But you anchor yourself compensation-wise wherever you start. And
yes.
whatever yourself or poorly you do, negotiating for yourself is going to follow
you.
It sticks with you. And so even with these younger kids where they're facing less bias and there's probably better pay practices and there's more controls on the compensation side and people are probably following better governance around things at entry level. It's always easier to control things at entry level jobs. If you're disinclined to negotiate, I could coach you all day long on negotiating. I don't like doing it for myself.
I agree.
I don't.
So what's out there then for young women entering the workforce? For example, Michael, you're thinking about your daughter probably while you're listening to this, right? And don't you have a team, a lot of women on your team?
Yeah, I do. I just want to really focus on the manager and leaders, and you said culture. Managers are the ones that will implement an initiative. It has to be structured as an initiative. Well, the people that it's being delivered to know that the only reason it's being done is because it's an initiative and those managers have to do it. It takes leaders to change a culture. A leader doesn't need an initiative.
Right.
A leader will change a culture in a team. And I was talking to Dan and Kate earlier. In my previous role, I had 18 folks that worked on my team. One of my employees or co-workers came up to me and said, "You realize you only have 2 white males on your team?" And I didn't have a stat sheet. I didn't hire that way. And it just, I sat back and I said, "Oh yeah, I guess you're right." But I didn't need an initiative to build a team like that. And it created a culture where people started to see, my team started with me and 3 others. So it went from 3 to 18. And people see within the company that there's a culture. They could see that there's, all right, I can't go to that team because it's only this or it's only that. And I think it's on leaders. And you just brought me back 17 years ago when I got relocated here to Texas. I was hiring an administrative assistant. And I remember the HR person coming up to me, who are you going to choose? And I said who the person was. And she goes, "You're definitely choosing her, right?" I said, "Yeah, she's the best candidate." "All right, now I have to tell you, she's going to have a baby." And I was like, "Okay, awesome. Her guest have a shower." But to me, I had to stamp it in stone, almost like she was putting it to me, like, I can't back out now. And she wanted to get my answer. I said, "Well, I waited for 8 months. This is the best candidate. I could surely wait 2 more months or 3 more months for the best candidate." So it's kind of interesting hearing that story, and it just took me back to that. But overall, it's leadership. It's creating that culture. And like you said, now you spread the word about these companies are doing it well. That's a natural recruiting tool. Those companies are going to win over the next 5 and 10 years. Yeah. And you can't mandate the change. You can't. An initiative is great. You can have some balloons and kick it off and send emails out. But people know when you're doing it because you have to do it, as opposed to you're doing it because it's part of the culture.
Well, and it impacts whether or not that change is sustainable, too. Mm-hmm. If it's a box-checking exercise, we're going to put in your performance review. The one I always see is, like, you have to interview diverse slates of candidates. No one's actually going back to look. They're not going back and asking your HR business partner if you did it. So it's an entirely meaningless thing anyway. But it's like this box checking. Okay, I talked to a diverse slate of candidates. You want to get the best people. And when you do that, you're going to end up with a diverse group of people. In some industries you won't. If the candidate pool isn't, and then you've got to think about, well, how are we recruiting? Where are we recruiting from? Why are we... that's where you want to make like the targeted.
What's interesting is you talked about leaders and then you talked about culture and JLL. And I'm relatively new to JLL, about 60 days in. But what I can tell you is being on an account level and being on an account that I'm on, there's a company culture and then there's an account culture.
Yeah, for sure.
And it's really based upon the leadership within an account as far as being able to develop within. One of the key things that I noticed coming on board is this skip level meetings. So even though you may get a manager that may not be have network throughout the organization, you have 2 and 3 level skip levels. So like 3 levels above me may come down and talk to my team, you know, to be able to open up the avenue and the opportunities of growth and development within the account level. Now the scary thing is now that I've heard you, I'm saying, okay, well, if I go outside this account, what does the terrain look like, you know? But I think it is based upon leadership, the leadership of that organization or account, and how they actually push that down. Now, within our group, we do, obviously our account is Capital One, and we do the Southwest region for Capital One. And these three ladies here, she's a lead, so these two ladies here are on my team. And of our team, when we look at the diversity mix, about 90 to 95% of the people on my team are male. And the leadership within our team is here, minus one guy. Mm-hmm. And so it is definitely a different work dynamic. The ceiling is not there from a leadership perspective, but definitely from the confidence level for our direct reports, who are engineers, maintenance guys, used to be within their group, you know. And so it's definitely, for us, it's continuing having that network around to say, you can do it. Great, what is the question? Let's get you the support you need to be successful. Before you go ask that question, ask me, I fill you in, you know, to be able to show the team that the value that you bring and that you can actually handle the position that you need.
And I think when I started 2 years ago, everybody would notice this, but I was the only female on the facility side on the entire campus. There was 13 engineers under us and our entire FM team, and I was the only female. So I would always introduce myself, hi, my name is Nikki. I'm the only female. No worries, but so it was, you know, when we did have this change, it was great to have additional females on the team. But even then, 2 years ago, our managers in general, and everybody above him, never made me feel like you're not going anywhere. Like you're the only female here. You're not. It wasn't like that, and it was actually completely opposite. I was like, yeah, you're doing great. You're gonna go somewhere. So I was the only female on the team, but I didn't feel like there was a black ceiling. I didn't feel like, yeah, you're gonna stay down here, it's okay. You're not gonna have an opportunity. It wasn't like that at all, so.
But I think you also, to speak to what you said, you didn't have the sticky floor syndrome, where you didn't have that drive to go somewhere.
I have the drive, but I had that second, you know, when you have that thought that you're like, can I do this? This is engineering, it's very male dominated. I've told Bri, I've had an engineer come to me and say, entire engineering team doesn't really like you. It was kind of that like fear factor to come and tell you, like, you know, you don't really know much, and never mentioned anything about me being a woman. But it was kind of that, on top of the fact that you're young, you're kind of a lady, we don't really like you. And my response was, well, thank you very much, you know, if you need anything from me, let me know, but I'll interview, and if they find me to be the best candidate, then, you know, it'll happen. Didn't have nothing to say after that. So I mean, yeah, that was a sticky situation. You have like a thought goes through, like, can I really do this? But then it disappears, and you're like, yeah, I'm fine. We're good. Don't worry. We'll learn. We've got this, you know? But, the sticky floor wasn't that, you know, important to me. It was a glimpse, but not really, so.
And part of the reason we're here is because we have decided we need to network outside of the account.
Yeah. Yeah.
And to really partner with the Dallas office and events that comes up. And so we have actively, this is the second event that we've been at. And we're
going
really
to the Dallas Women's Business Network events.
Yeah. We'll be doing that.
Mm-hmm. But that's great. There's a thread. I've just been making notes because I'm always thinking about what can we do with content? What can we do with the sun? What can we do with the next event? What can we do with another chapter? What can we do? What can we do? And there's this thread about leadership and culture is really quite universal in this room, and must be beyond. So that's really interesting. I never expected it to kind of go that way. So I want to say thanks. This is great because I've made a ton of notes and I want to do more around this. I just want to, do I have time? Another question, and then we can keep talking. Okay. All right. Results from the survey show that 59% of the participants feel that companies offer management roles without gender discrimination. If this is true, then why aren't we seeing more women in senior positions? Or is that not true?
No, I think it is. I do think it's true. I mean, that's
the crux,
right? Real statistic. Yeah. And I say this based on, I've been in the same organization for 13 years, so I feel like I have a pretty broad view of what's going on. I still see a lot of women self-select out because of personal decisions. Mm-hmm. And the reason I think that's important is because then there's less of us. And so statistically, it just gets more difficult to get into those more senior roles. And I think
developing countries, it's actually easier to go to work as a woman because you have the extended family.
Mm-hmm.
You can, you have someone there to help you with your children. It is, in some ways, it is easier to go to work in a developing country than it is in first world countries. And so I think stuff like that, it has a real, I mean, that's, if you sit and look at it, you think it's actually going to cost me more money to keep working. Or, and I think the other thing that happens is it's awfully hard to go back. You lose a lot of traction, even if you take
a
short break.
If you stay home, the children are
yeah.
going to work.
Yeah. Even if you do it for a shorter period of time.
Right.
One thing that I'm seeing now is, and I don't know, I know this has cropped up in certain geographical markets, and it's the one I know of is the Mom Project, and it's like a placement service, but their whole thing is to help women who have left the workforce to raise their children go back as freelancers. And I think stuff like that will begin to have an impact over a period of time, because we have moved, the economy has shifted, you have a lot more people freelancing. And there's no stigma attached to that really anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And so instead of saying, I left my job, my career behind to go raise my children, you say, I decided I wanted to freelance.
I'm hearing more and more about that, and companies actually using that
yeah.
as tremendous value.
Yeah.
We just did a whole thing on the gig economy
yeah.
in our magazine, which had a lot of that. So yeah.
And I think there's the unintended consequence there is that I think it'll help women. Because women leave the workforce more than men do when the economy takes a downturn. I mean, we're disproportionately affected by that because we can often, not all of us, but if you have a family, you can say, well, the economy's not very good, I'm going to stay home and take care of my kids, or this, that, or the other, right? You make these choices, and then it's hard to go back. But this whole idea that you can freelance and that's a career choice, that's not a personal choice. People don't view that as a personal choice. They view that as a career choice. And how employers view that stuff matters, because then you have a story to tell about your resume that doesn't involve you taking a work break. It involves you making an empowered decision about the things you're enthusiastic about that you wanted to pursue professionally, which is very different when you try to go back to work full time.
Sure.
But I think it's that opting out thing that really kills us, because, I mean, Kay can probably talk about this. I think women graduating, getting undergraduate degrees outnumber men at this point in the U.S. anyway. So it's not as if there aren't, we're out there in equal numbers certainly in professions, and we're just not getting.
Yeah, and so you look at, you know, supply chain, maybe outsourcing, there's some industries, engineering, science, that, you know, typically women haven't chosen to go to. So it's no surprise to me that there's so few senior leaders that are women, because if only 3% were coming out, you know, 20 years ago, they're not old enough to be in those senior roles. And so now 30% are coming out. So you just have to let the system, you know, by natural number, 30% coming out now have a much better chance 30 years from now to take those jobs than the poor 3% coming out. There's statistically, they don't have a chance, right? Because they didn't enter in. And so to me, and what I loved about Procter & Gamble is they said, you know, I'm going to go in and I'm going to raise the numbers, not because I'm trying to hit a quota, but I'm going to go educate people that these jobs are cool jobs. And that's what we've done at the University of Tennessee, is we go out to all the, you know, freshmen and sophomores and even high schoolers. We've won the number one, depending on the ranking, but between number one and number five in the world in supply chain. We're like, look at the salaries that I was getting. This is amazing. Don't you want to come work, get a supply chain degree? And they're like, wow, that's awesome. Of course I want a supply chain degree. So the more we educate them that you don't have to go work in a warehouse and toss boxes, that the more our numbers go from 3% to 30%. So to me, we have to get the people excited about science and engineering.
belong to Association of Women in Technology, and that is specifically for technology, math, and science. And I think that, I don't know what the statistics, I don't remember the number, but like 20 years ago, there were more women going into math and science. And just for exactly what you're talking about, my daughters today, you think about kids today, what, like, that are teenagers, what are they doing? They're looking at their phone,
Yeah.
So that's what that organization is about, is trying to get women into math, science, technology. And I believe it's a struggle right now.
Isn't it?
I encourage you to keep encouraging. But just like you're saying too, you got to go out and educate people on what's
the cool
factor
mentors,
of being a
mentors
nerd.
Mentors in these organizations, yeah. Like the organization you belong to, do they have a mentorship program?
Yes, they do.
Do you find a lot of that? To me, and I'm one of the dinosaurs, I go to a restaurant and I see every kid in a high chair with an iPad.
Right. Mm-hmm.
To me, that seems like a natural, this guy's going to go into technology. I mean, look, he's doing it as a child, you know.
Yeah.
I had a car phone, you plugged in, you pulled the cord out of the bag, you know, I thought that was the coolest thing ever. So there really are these kinds of programs for women. Do they have anything at Freedom Mortgage that is like that?
A lot informal. Again, I think it goes back to leadership. When you see someone with a high potential, you put them together. Hey, you've got really high potential. Here's a well-respected female executive in the company. If you're okay, I'd like to reach out to her. Everybody's always willing to help. And it actually, you know, you feel good when somebody comes to you and asks your advice. And again, I go back to, yeah, there are formal mentoring programs. I've been in those companies. And when I was a mentee, oh gosh, I got to go bother him again. It's the last thing he wants to do is talk to me for an hour to help me. And, you know, again, it was formal and it was structured. When you can find somebody in an informal way and ask them, hey, I've got some coaching the last 2 years. I've got to get better at this. Every time I see you, whether it's a male or female, man, you can just get up and speak in front of a crowd. Would you mind once a quarter we get together, maybe I can take you to lunch and tell me how you got comfortable and how I can do it? Can you listen in blindly on a call that I'm leading and give me feedback? To me, you can tell I'm a big fan of the unstructured people. It needs to come from the heart, and they need to want to do it.
It makes a huge difference, and I see this with people. They go like cold calling mentors. Somebody tells them I've seen people lose. They, you know what you need? You need a mentor. And then they literally, well, who can be my mentor? And they kind of like go through like the company directory. I could get that person to be my mentor. But things like that don't work because you don't have the personal connection. And I think you've got to find somebody. I mean, and Kate actually knows the person who was my mentor at work, Bill Thummler. He was the scariest guy in the firm. This is a true story. Very scary. People were terrified of this man. I wasn't smart enough to be scared of him. But I realized I needed a mentor. And he and I had a very good relationship because I had worked on some projects for him. And I just like girded myself, and I sent him an email because he was getting ready to change jobs, and I said, I need a mentor outside of my group, and I know you're changing jobs, and I've worked on these projects with you. Would you be willing to do that? And he did, but he did because he and I had a relationship, and it was, I can't tell you, I mean, my career was helped infinitely by that, and it was because he and I had a personal connection, and it was not artificial. It makes a real difference, and so when you can find that. But I think the other thing that I would say about that is you don't have to have a female advocate or mentor, and a lot gender partnership is really important.
Yeah, I never had a female mentor. I've never had a female mentor ever.
And you don't only have to have just one.
Right.
No,
that's
exactly.
And especially if you're in an industry where the numbers are upside down.
Yeah.
Like I sat through an event with, I'm a co-chair for Women's Business Network in Chicago, and I sat through an event with all the other co-chairs from around the country. And we had a whole long conversation about gender partnership, and there was something that went on for like 25 minutes about like all the wrongs the white men had done to all of us. And at some point, I raised my hand and I said, you know, I mean, I have a leadership position within the firm. There's no cabal of white guys behind a curtain
trying to hold us back.
Right.
And furthermore, all my mentors and advocates have actually been like 50-year-old white men all through my career. And because the men way outnumber the women.
Yeah.
So if you're going to get ahead, you might not want to take an adversarial position. You might want to find that connection. And what you will find is there's a lot of guys like Michael who have daughters who aren't like scared to have coffee with you because you're a woman.
Yeah.
And they're actually interested in the advocacy of it. They have sisters, they have moms who work. You know, a lot of men are pretty invested in it. And even if they're not for personal reasons, most of them are incented because they want their teams to do well and they want the best people on their teams.
Yeah.
And if you're the best person.
Yeah, and it's interesting because you look at your statistic, which I thought was, you know, is a good one. You know, so you had more people, kids a while back that went into science and they bounced out, right? And it's because there's this, you know, when you have so many, you know, dinosaurs, that's all they've ever known was, you know, this way. So the vast majority, you got these people and they bounce out. But now you're starting to get more and more. And as I say, it's a system problem that's like if you think about a snake, right? And every inch of the snake is 100 people. And you got the women coming in supply chain. If it was only 3%, it's a little tiny little thing, right? And so it's going to take forever for them, those 3%, to make it up to the tail of the snake. And so now that you've got 30%, it'll work through. That whole front head is going to, you know, so it's going to take decades. And what I find fascinating is just listen to what we said, right? So if you had someone in here for each decade, the decade before you, not good at all. Yours, there's definitely stuff there, right? Mine, didn't really see any, you start to see a little bit, right? But now you go to this decade, there's none. And so they're not at the glass ceiling yet, or they look and you're new. The new guys coming in from PepsiCo, by the way, y'all recruit a lot of our students. Thank you so much. You know, they look at you and you're like, of course there's no glass ceiling. We got to, like, they can't even imagine that. It's like you can't even imagine it. So we were lucky that we went to good companies. You were lucky because you had good manager and then had, you know, so you had a mix. We were just happy to be lucky with good managers. But now you've got enough people going through that. But I think not just your decade, because now you're like, ooh, I was told it should be scary. Oh, it really wasn't. The group after you, there's going to be no issue. But that's for your guys to make it to the CEO level, you got another 30 years, mm-hmm. right, to work the system through. And so I really think it's a system problem. And what makes me so excited, you actually track. If you've got decades, people by decades, and you say, good company experience, mixed company experience, right? And there'll still be a couple of bad company experience with some old dinosaurs. But over time, that system's going to flush out. And I mean, you saw it right here in this room. The difference between 10 years in each decade is very telling.
Well, I have a question for everyone. I have three adult daughters. I don't think one of them would say that they would expect a glass ceiling or expect to be held back. I don't think that they would even see it. Now, they may get into an organization and it happens, but I also think that young people, and I may be wrong, so I'm asking this question, do you feel like, or maybe I'm the only one with adult daughters, but the opportunities, it's different in school, it's different in their peer groups than it was, you know, when I was in the same situation. I feel like, for me, and this is really dating myself, when I just finished college, my first professional job, got my suit, show up for work, have my orientation, and this is how old I am. This was at one of the Big Ten accounting firms, so you can imagine how long ago that was. I went through the orientation. My number one most important job, number one responsibility, that all the partners had coffee at 4 o'clock.
Oh, okay.
So I got the 4 o'clock coffee hour because I was the new one. And that was it. Didn't matter what I was working on, didn't matter what was going on. 4 o'clock, I'd be in there with those big bun machines making the coffee, and I couldn't leave until, you know, 11 of these things. I was on a panel in India 10 years ago and told that story, and even then they looked at me like, So is it, do people feel in, you know, with the young people they work with or even their own children that it's different now? So will they naturally not experience
that? I think they have very, I think millennials, that's have very different expectations.
Yeah, and
I roll my eyes at it a lot. I'll be honest with you, but you know, like the 22-year-old wants to work on strategy. Like, on the one hand, I find that completely absurd, and they don't think they need to do their own expense reports. Like, stuff like that drives me nuts.
But
on the other hand, I suspect that the positive side of that kind of behavior is that they don't see limitations.
Yeah.
Well, that's the one.
Right.
There's a lot
of negatives there, I think.
I had a millennial live with me. My niece came
there's
to live
exception.
With me.
There's
exceptions. I still, oh my gosh.
But I do think that's a great insulator because I don't think that generation, you know, the things about it that I find degrading, like, you know, I'm Generation X. I feel like there were dues I had to pay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the things you have to do. I think that idea that you're not constrained by those things actually in some ways probably very good. And it probably helps any group that's underrepresented because the younger kids just don't feel the same.
They don't have a sticky floor.
They don't know what it is.
I think in a company culture there are things that need to be done. It's not about a macro view of individual capability or opportunity, but there are things that can be done. We all want to be successful at work, but we also want to be successful in life. And to do that, we need work-life balance. Work-life balance doesn't mean work less, life more. It means flexibility in the way we do our work. And that's for everyone. It's maternity leave and paternity leave. It's child care options. It's aging parent care options. Those are programs that companies can put in place to allow people to be fully who they are, both with life and work. Number two, going back to our original topic today, we need a performance-based culture. It's not about style and how someone delivers a message, it's the substance of what's being delivered. It's not about the where they work or how many hours of work or how hard they seem to work, it's about the outcomes that they're achieving in that work and being compensated and rewarded for that work in the same manner across an organization. And when those two elements are in place, it helps promote that culture that we talk about. Because yes, core values are important. Yes, what's tolerated or not tolerated is important, but more importantly, it's what's expected as in a performance-based culture and in a work-life balance culture.
You know, what's interesting is we talk about millennials and talk about what he was saying. I call it the Starbucks environment, because that younger generation feels that not just the entitlement, but also the fact that I can get the same output by working from Starbucks.
Right.
And like, whatever you need, I don't really need to go in today. You know, I don't need to be on a conference call. You know, I got the inputs and I can create whatever that is. And then when they get to that sweet spot, then they can work for employers and do really, really well and get to that innovation stage. But when they find that they're not getting there with employers, then they go to the freelance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they say, I'm going to sit at Starbucks, I create a business.
and I mean, I can say this from a real estate function, and we can all, this is fundamentally changing our business.
Mm-hmm.
It is fundamentally changing because our clients are trying to react to that.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you think about it, just the fact that it's changing the way people manage and design and lease office space, you just think about the real estate impact of it.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't even get to the, then think about the cultural impact that kind of stuff has.
Yeah.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
it's incredible.
You know, Joe, you talked about the programs you put in, and most of those all cater to white collar workers, right? And it was interesting, so, you know, in logistics and supply chain, you know, warehousing and transportation, whatever, you know, Dell had a problem with women workers at some of these lower entry-level jobs, especially like warehouse, so or temp labor, you know, the receiving, because you can still do a lot of work. And on the first day of school, none of the women came to work. And they're all like, oh, you're evil, you're mean. And then they thought, these are actually good workers.
wrap it up. Okay. I thought this was great. Don't tell Chitra we only did two questions. This was great. I want to thank the panel. This has, I think, opened up a lot of ideas and thoughts and things we could all be focused on. That's important. Thank you to all of you for participating.
Yes.
See, that's how we got you to stay, because this is at the end. Okay. You want to hand them out? I'm going to read the names. Amanda McLean. Amanda McLean?
Amanda?
Amanda McLean. Am I reading it right? No? Okay. Bree.
Bria.
Yay! His handwriting is terrible, so if I push his name, it's his fault. Karen.
Yes.
Wow. Natasha. And Julie. Well, that went down well. Peter Mueller.
Oh, I think he just left.
He just left.
He just walked out.
Peter Mueller. Oh. Sarah Wiseman. Is it Kedra?
Yes.
Okay.
Hey.
Thank you. Okay, great. Do you want to just pick another one?
Was that the list? So we have three notes.
We have, who are we missing? Amanda?
Amanda.
I'm
Amanda.
It's not McLean.
I'm not McLean.
You see, I'm not crazy.
Yeah,
right?
That's me today.
Okay, so we think Peter's not here. If you want to just.
Anybody else want a book?
I'm hitting the wine. I don't know about
anything. Until 8:30. 15 minutes till the bar.
10 minutes to have the
15 till the. Yeah. So get over.